So yeah, thank you, Karen, for your introduction, and welcome to all of you who have joined us today for this webinar on utilizing Pion SiriusT3, an analytical instrument. My name, as you know, is Rebeca Ruiz, and I'm the Global Manager of Analytical Service at Pion. So this talk is divided into parts. In the first part, I will talk about the instrument characteristics and the assay which can perform with it. And in the second part, Dr. Clara Rafols, full professor from the University of Barcelona, will explain a solubility case study in more detail. So, the development of small molecule drug candidates from the discovery phase to the marketed product continues to be challenging enterprise with very low success rates. And as a part of an effort to understand in more depth the reasons for candidate failure, there has been considerable interest in analyzing the physicochemical properties, such as ionization constant, lipophilicity, and solubility, as the key to develop a successful pharmaceutical active ingredient into a drug. The physicochemical properties of a molecule that are consistent with the potential for good oral absorption were initially defined by Lipinski. His rule of five was published in 1897, and now everyone takes note of his assertion that molecules with high log P and low solubility rarely become successful drugs. The ionization constant, or pKa, defines the transition between the neutral and an ionized molecule, making a profound difference to the way it behaves in solution, as well in the human body. For example, the neutral form is less soluble than the ionized form. Also, the neutral form is more lipophilic than the ionized form, meaning that it dissolves better in oils and fat than it does in water. Lipophilicity is described by log P value and is the ratio between the solubility of neutral species dissolved in lipid and in water. The way drugs are absorbed into the human body is mostly via a process called passive diffusion, in which the neutral form of the drug enters membrane by dissolving in the lipid phase of the membrane. So pKa, log P, and solubility can help us to understand this process. How we are measuring the physicochemical properties? In this slide, I would like to show you the three generations of potentiometric instruments for the determination of the physicochemical properties designed by Pion, formerly Sirius. I've worked with the PCA101 throughout my thesis, an automatic potentiometer which uses a pH metric technique for the determination of pKa and log P. This instrument contains similar refinement calculations to those we are using today. The GLPKA with T-pass introduced the UV metric technique for the determination of pKa and the potentiometric solubility, and our current system, PionSiriusT3, which reduces by a factor of 10 the amount of sample tight transfer media from the previous instrument, the GLPKA, incorporating the same techniques already mentioned, plus the addition of the fast UV, which allow us to measure pKa in just a few minutes at very low concentrations. So PionSiriusT3 measurement cell is a 4 milliliters vial provided with a miniature pH electrode of 3 millimeters in diameter, as well as 6 quarts capillary encased in a ceramic tube of 2 millimeters diameter, which dispense the titanium media. The cell also incorporates a stirrer, temperature probe, and a spectroscopic UV probe, which detects absorbance and turbidity. This is all immersed in a 1 centimeter diameter glass vial, enable titrations in just only 1.5 milliliters of solution under argon. Additionally, the instrument detects turbidity using a red LED that shines through the solution onto the photodiode detector. So let's start with looking at ionization constant. The definition of ionization constant, or pKa, is rather hard to summarize in words, but for molecules with only one pKa, we can say that pKa is the pH at which half the molecules in aqueous solution exist in ionized form and half exist in the neutral form. So the pH when 50% of the molecules are ionized and 50% are neutral. As a way to understand the ionization constant, I would like to explain the behavior of thymol blue under changing pH conditions. Thymol blue is a pH indicator and changes color depending on the pH due to the different species present in solution. Thymol blue has two pKa's. The first one is 1.7 and the second is 8.9. If the solution is a low pH below the first pKa, the sample is neutral and it's red. If we increase the pH between 2.8 and 8, the molecule loses its protons marked with a dark green circle. The main species is monoanionic and the color is yellow. Increasing the pH higher than its second pKa, 8.9, the sample loses the second proton marked with a light green circle. The main species is dianionic and the color is blue. Many drugs are ionizable molecules and therefore have pKa's. Ionizable drugs have structural groups that pick up or lose protons and they convert between different ionized forms as the pH changes, as we observe in the example of thymol blue. Most drugs are poorly soluble in water and co-solvents needs to be used. T3 enables the use of different solvents like acetonitrile, methanol, isopropanol, dioxin, etc. However, by using different solvents, we are changing the dielectric constant of the media and the energies of solvation between the molecule and the two solvents, the water and the organic solvent, among others. Therefore, the aqueous equilibrium of the compound in the media is disturbed because the addition of the second solvent. So in other words, when changing the media, the pKa also changes. This is the case of imipramine. Imipramine is a base with a pKa of 9.34. The analysis was performed in different percentages of methanol water from 60 to 40%. It's easy to observe that when the sample is 50% ionized for the different methanol percentage, the pKa changes. Here is the case of captopril. Captopril has two pKa's and both are acids. In this case, the percentage of methanol water used was from 50 to 30%. And again, both pKa's change with the media composition. However, it's interesting to observe that the pKa changes in a different direction if we compare both cases. In the case of imipramine, when the percentage of methanol increases, the pKa decreases. While in the case of captopril, when the percentage of methanol increases, both pKa's increase. In other words, usually the pKa increases with the decrease of the solvent percentage for the bases, while acids behave in the opposite way. To determine the pKa in water, an extrapolation to aqueous conditions needs to be performed. At Pion, we are using the Yasuda-Shedlowski and the linear extrapolation equations to obtain the pKa's in water. How are we measuring the pKa's? Pion SiriusT3 uses two techniques. The spectrometric technique is for UV active drugs, meaning compound with chromophore groups close to the ionized center. This technique calculates the result from the changes in the UV spectra as the sample is ionized, based on the theory that the two species have different spectra. The potentiometric technique is for UV active and non-UV active drugs. in which the pKa is obtained by titrating the sample between pH 2 and 12 and calculating the pKa using mass and char balance equations. For the spectrometric technique, we have two methods, the fast UV and the UV metric. The fast UV method is a screening method because it only takes a few minutes to obtain a result and requires a small quantity of sample. It operates between pH 2 and 12 and uses a safe reference spectrum, so it's quick and efficient. The second spectrometric technique is the UV metric technique, which operates over a wider pH, below pH 2 and above pH 12. And it uses a fresh reference spectrum for each sample. The UV metric technique is therefore more precise than fast UV, but requires a longer assay time to get a result. The pH metric technique is the most powerful because it can find any pKa, regardless of whether or not the sample is UV active. However, it requires a greater amount of sample. This slide shows the validation of the pKa techniques used by T3, the UV metric versus the potentiometric. You can also find on this slide interesting published papers about the techniques covered. Lipophilicity. So, what is log P? P is the partition coefficient and is the ratio between the neutral species concentrations dissolved in two immiscible phases when the system is at equilibrium. Usually, a system of octanol and water is used. However, with T3, several partition solvents could also be used, like toluene, totecane, chloroform, etc. Coming back to the case of the thymol blue. The neutral species, the one with the red color, is extracted into the octanol layer. However, the other two species, the monoanionic with yellow color and the dianionic with blue, they will stay in the water layer when the pH increases, as they are charged. In other words, the aqueous media simulate the bloodstream and the organic phase, the octanol. And the organic phase, the octanol, is simulated the membranes. The neutral species is the one which be able to go through the tissue. However, the ionized species will not be absorbed effectively and they will stay in the bloodstream. However, SiriusT3 works at the physiological ionic strength. Therefore, the ionic strength of the water and solvents used is adjusted to 0.50 molar using potassium chloride. This strong background electrolyte can create ion pairs with the ionized drug. As a consequence of that, we can observe how the monoanionic species, yellow, is extracted to the octanol layer by just adding dissolved potassium chloride. The red neutral species is extracted as expected, but the yellow monoanionic species is also extracted in the form of ion pairs, giving the orange color at pH 4.8, something that is unexpected when the solution was in octanol and pure water. This slide helps to understand how the potentiometric log-P method works. In the water layer, we have the compound in equilibrium between the ionized and neutral forms. However, by adding octanol, we disrupt this equilibrium as the neutral species begins to partition to the octanol layer, as we observe with the thymol blue. If the neutral species partition, the equilibrium in water will be decompensated for the neutral species lost, and consequently, the measured pKa will shift. The higher the log P, the bigger the shift of the pKa will be observed. It's quite interesting to observe that the pKa of bases like diacetylmorphine measured in the presence of octanol shift to lower pH values. And the pKa of acids, la flumequin, shifts to higher pH values, similar as we observe in the case of the pKa with solvents. The potentiometric technique is used for the determination of the log-P and is applicable only for ionizable compounds, meaning that the aqueous pKa of the compound needs to also be determined. A titration is performed between pH 2 and 12, and mass and balance equations are used for the determination of the pKa, the pKa in the presence of octanol. Using the aqueous pKa determined and the log P, the log D versus pH profile is calculated. This slide shows the validation of the potentiometric log P versus the well-known shake flask methodology. You can also find on this slide interesting published papers based on the technique. Before I explain solubility, I would like to show you two case studies. The first one is rose bengal. We received this compound in our analytical service department for a pKa determination. Rose bengal has two pKa's predicted. However, when the UV metric technique was used, only one pKa was measured from the UV data collated. Something quite surprising. Looking at the structure of rose bengal, it's easy to see the symmetry between the two ionizable groups. However, based on our experience, symmetrical ionizable groups don't have the same pKa. And the reason is because compounds change conformation in solution. Ionizable centers with 4-5 bonds away from chromophore groups could be detected by UV thanks to the flexibility of the structure. However, rose bengal is not flexible. It's a very rigid structure. Consequently, the pKa's are exactly the same, something very unusual. To confirm that the sample had two pKa's and not one, a potentiometric determination was performed using the T3. The concentration factor is the relation between the amount of sample titrated and the amount of sample weight. The concentration factor determined was almost 2, meaning that the instrument titrated 2 ionizable groups and not 1, confirming that the sample had 2 pKa's. The spectrometric and the potentiometric techniques used by T3 are complementary, one to the other. And the same story has to be explained by both. This is the reason that in analytical service, we always use both to confirm results, and we highly recommend to use them together for the determination of any pKa. The next case study is indomethacin. Indomethacin has a carboxylic acid with a pKa of 4. The titration was performed UV-metrically from high pH, where the sample was completely ionized to help dissolution. The pKa determined with this technique was 3.87. Once the pKa was determined, the log-P was also performed, and it was when the results didn't make sense. The concentration factor of indomethacin was 2. Meaning that the instrument was titrating double the amount of sample. However, this is not the same case of rose bengal, because indomethacin only has 1 pKa. It turns out that indomethacin decomposes a high pH, giving 2 acids as the composition products. Both acids have carboxylic acid groups with a pKa around 4. Because the pKa of the products have a similar pKa to indomethacin, it's quite common not to notice the decomposition, especially if the determination is done uvimetrically, starting at high pH when indomethacin is already decomposed. Performing a potentiometric titration enables us to realize that the sample decomposed into compounds as two pKa were analyzed. So once the decomposition of indomethacin was understood, an additional uvimetric triple titration was performed with SiriusT3 from low pH to compare the changes in the UV spectra at low and high pH, as it shown in the slide. The different spectra confirm the analysis of different samples. I would like to explain how we are measuring solubility with the Pion SiriusT3. Using the check salt technique, our patented method. To explain the check salt solubility, I'm going to use verapamil as example. Verapamil is a base with a pKa of 8.7. The sample is weighed into a vial and 1.5 milliliters ionic strength adjusted water at 0.15 molar with potassium chloride is added. The pH is adjusted with hydrochloric acid to pH 2, where the sample is fully dissolved. Then the titration starts by adding potassium hydroxide to induce precipitation. Absorbance data is continuously collected, and when verapamil starts to precipitate, the light is scattered and an increment in absorbance is observed. At this point, the kinetic solubility is determined. However, the experiment doesn't stop here, and the pH readings are carefully recorded. Why? Because by reading the pH, the software determines when the sample is precipitating or dissolving. Verapamil is a base, so when the sample is precipitating, protons are released to the media. If more protons are in solution, the pH goes down, meaning that the sample is precipitating. Then the instrument adds acid. Verapamil takes the proton from the media to dissolve. The concentration of protons in solutions go down, meaning that the pH goes up. The sample is dissolving. Then the instrument at base, pH goes down. The sample is precipitating. Then at acid, pH goes up. The sample is dissolving. The pH goes up and down, changing the slope from positive to negative for a minimum of 10 cycles. The system would be at equilibrium when the slope is zero. Then the intrinsic solubility is determined. The potentiometric technique CheckSol is used for the determination of the kinetic and intrinsic solubility. It's only applicable to ionizable compounds, meaning that the aqueous pKa of the compound needs to also be determined. Using the aqueous pKa determined and the intrinsic solubility, the log S versus pH profile is also calculated. The beauty of CheckSol method is that it can determine the solubility of a compound from 40 minutes to 1 hour, 2 hours, depending on the sample. While shake flask method needs a minimum of 48 hours to reach equilibrium. We validated our CheckSol technique, and you will find in this slide our published patent and very interesting papers explaining this technique. Before I finish my part in this webinar, I would like to show a case study involving CheckSol technique with polymorphism. Triclosan is antibacterial and antifungal agent which has an acidic pKa of 8.06. We received this compound in our analytical service department for Chexol determination. In this graph, we have the concentration of the neutral species in solution versus time. The beginning of the say, the compound is completely ionized, so the concentration of the neutral species is zero. However, once the titration starts, the concentration of the neutral species is starting to increase and is still increasing until precipitation is detected. Then we have the kinetic solubility. The instrument is then adding acid and base and the sample starting to dissolve and precipitated as previously explained. The graph suggests that the first precipitation is an amorphous form with a higher solubility that is temporarily stabilized. However, after 20 minutes, a change in the form of the precipitation is observed from the amorphous to a more crystalline form, which is more stable form with lower solubility. Following these observations, the experiment was repeated and the precipitates were collected, and the first and the second precipitation event. This slide shows the two precipitates collected. The precipitates then were centrifuged for 2 minutes. If you carefully observe, we have here what appears to be an oil drop, while here we have a solid particle. We collected the oil and observed using the polarized microscope. The first screenshot shows small oil drops, and we can observe how they started to crystallize with time. We also observed the second precipitate through the polarized microscope, confirming that a crystalline form was collected. With the Chexol method, we determined the kinetic solubility of triclosan and the intrinsic solubility of two different forms. Dr. Clara Rafols will continue the webinar explaining a more detailed case study of supersaturation, showing how Chexol method could be a very useful tool to study the effect of excipients to enhancing solubility.
Thank you, Rebecca. In this part, we present how Chexol can help us to study the effect of excipients in the supersaturation behavior of a drug. But why we are interested in obtaining a supersaturation solution? Let me introduce the biopharmaceutical classification system. This system allows quick and easy evaluation of the potential absorption of a new drug, based upon two physical chemical properties, solubility and permeability, molecules are classified in 4 different classes. The first class, class 1, includes molecules which are highly soluble and highly permeable. Molecules in class 2 have good permeability but poor solubility, while molecules in class 3 are soluble but poorly permeable. Finally, molecules in class 4 have low solubility and low permeability. Molecules in class 1 are very suitable for pharmaceutical purpose. Nevertheless, to promote permeability, new drugs tend to have high molecular weight and lipophilicity, property that often decrease the solubility. Most of these new compounds are classified in class 2, where the absorption is limited by solubility. Therefore, there is an interest of increasing the solubility of these compounds as to be considered as class 1. In fact, keeping the concentration of the drug higher than its intrinsic solubility only during the digestion time may be enough to promote absorption. One of the strategies used to enhance the solubility of the drug is the use of additives, so that the drug can stay supersaturated in biological fluids for a period of time for a period of time long enough to allow absorption. The checksum method allows us evaluate impact of additive on the supersaturation of the drug to be evaluated. This graph represents a typical neutral species concentration versus time profile reported by checksum. The concentration of neutral species is increased until precipitation first occurs. This point corresponds to the kinetic solubility, where generally the concentration is higher than the intrinsic solubility, indicating that the drug solution is supersaturated just before the first precipitation is observed. However, this supersaturated solution is thermodynamically unstable and has the tendency to quickly return to the equilibrium state by precipitation of the most stable form of the drug. This is the crystalline form. Then, this graph allows us to estimate the extents and the duration of supersaturation of the drug in the study media. A supersaturation ratio is defined as the ratio of maximum measurement concentration of neutral species by the intrinsic solubility. To obtain a supersaturated solution and keep this concentration in uptime, we need to increase the duration of the supersaturation, slowing down or inhibiting the crystallization process. Moreover, it should be desirable to extend the duration and supersaturation as long as possible. The use of different excipients like polymers, surfactants, or cyclodextrins as additives to the drug formulation can help to create a supersaturation solution. In the next slide, we present how several polyvinyl pyrrolidone polymers, known as plasdone, modify the degree and extents of supersaturation of different drugs classified in class 2. The drugs selected have a different chemical nature and include diprotic acid, benzoflumetiazine and benztiazine that belong to the same family, monoprotic acid like diclofenac, isoxicam, ketoprofen, warfarin, diprotic base, dibucaina, olanzapine, tetracaine and tetracaine, and monoprotic bases like haloperidol, mapratilin, papaverine, pindolol and propanolol. This drug showed the typical neutral species concentration profile for a crystalline form. This shows that the drug supersaturate for only a short period of time. Compared to the intrinsic solubility, isoxicam is the one that the compounds which are supersaturated most highly, reaching a concentration almost sixfold greater than its intrinsic solubility. On the contrary, tetracaine hardly supersaturates, and the supersaturation ratio is close to one. Bupivacaina shows different behavior. It begins to precipitate at an amorphous form, but over time, this form is transformed into a more stable one. In all compounds studied, the supersaturation time is no longer than 15 minutes, so these examples will be suitable for increasing the duration of supersaturation. The polymers used were plasdones, 5K-type, which are homopolymers of vinyl pyrrolidone that can interact with the drug by hydrogen bond either through the nitrogen or the carbonyl group on the pyrrole group. Another plasdone was S613, which is a copolymer of vinyl pyrrolidone and vinyl acetate. To check the effect of these plasdones on drug solubility, checksol experiments were performed using physical mixtures of plasdones and drugs. Then, 3 different trends were observed in relation to the supersaturation of the study compounds. We choose 3 compounds to explain them. Begin with case A. In this graph, we show the concentration change of benzoflumetiazine when plasdone K12 is added. The solution stayed supersaturated at close to the maximum concentration of the entire duration of the experiment. That is, the concentration stay stable for a long time. This behavior is typical of an amorphous form. To verify the presence of these amorphous forms, we collect the precipitate at the end of the experiment and perform an X-ray diffraction analysis of the solid. Also, we dig X-ray of the pure plasdol, the commercial drug, and the drug after Chicxol experiments. As we can see, when plasdol is not present, the drug precipitates in a crystalline form, but the solid obtained is different from the commercial one. So, both compounds show some kind of polymorphisms. This is important to know because the intrinsic solubility reported by Chicxol for benzofluorethiazine corresponds to the obtained polymorph. The spectra obtained for plasdol K12 is characterized by the absence of sharp peaks with white bands, which are indicative of an amorphous solid. The solid drug collected in the presence of 50% of plasdona show only two sharp peaks, which in fact belong to the potassium chloride present in the titration measurements. Then, benzofluorethiazine precipitate in these conditions belongs to an amorphous solid. When different rations of plasdon drug were used, all solutions were kept supersaturated, but with a slight decrease of supersaturation concentration when the percentage of plasdon is increased. We also proved other K-type of plasdons. Here we can see that all these type plasdons provide the same result, and the supersaturations seem not to be affected by the degree of polymerization. However, when plasdona S630 is used, which contains vinyl acetate group in addition to the vinyl pyrrolidine ones, this showed little modification of the solubility behavior of benzofluorethiazine. Diclofenac, ketoprofen, and warfarin, all of acid compounds, behave in a similar way that benzofluorethiazine in the presence of plasdon. Diclofenac and ketoprofen interact only with plasdona's K-type, and their solubility is stabilized in 17-fold and 2-fold its intrinsic solubility, respectively. Warfarin interacts with plasdon S630 in a similar way to K-type plasdonas, increasing the solubility approximately 20 times. The second behavior observed is the one that the maximum concentration of the drug increases but for a limited period of time. This is the case of benzthiazide. The addition of 630 provokes a greater effect than key types. Moreover, the extension and time of supersaturation increases with the percentage of plasdon S630. The supersaturation ratio increased from 8 to 750 at 75%, and the supersaturation time from 4 to 40 minutes. We also performed the regex diffraction of the solid. This is plasdon alone, commercial drug, and the solid collected after Chicxol experiments. As benzofluorethiazine, the solid collected in absence of plasdon precipitate in a crystalline form, but different from the commercial one. So, this substance also presents some kind of polymorphism. Now, the spectra obtained for the solid collected in presence of plasdons also belongs to a crystalline form and is the same the one obtained in absence of plasdon. Then, in this case, plasdon ionivide precipitation and higher concentration of drug can be reached in solution. However, after a relative short time, start to precipitate and the concentration in solution fall to the intrinsic solubility value. Other compounds which show similar behaviors are isoxicam, pindolone, and olanzapine. Here we can see that the supersaturation time of isoxicam increases when the degree of polymerization. Although pindolol and olanzapine are bases, the use of plasdone provokes similar behavior. Again, the plasdone S630 is the one that most changes the supersaturation parameters. In the third case, there is no interaction at all between the drug and the different plasdones, so that the solubility is not affected by the addition of the polymers. This is the case of tetracain and the case of the rest bases compost studied. To end with this webinar, I would like to state some conclusions. First, spectrophotometric and potentiometric assay are used to determine the physicochemical properties of the compounds. SiriusT3 allows to determine the pKa and logP parameters which they are recognized as setting the industry standard. Potentiometric solubility checksum method provide the intrinsic solubility in around 1 hour. Study with excipients can help to predict which excipient it will be more effective in extending and or prolonging supersaturation. Finally, the check-sol method not only provides the kinetic solubility, it can be also used to determine the intrinsic solubility of different forms, amorphous or crystalline one. We would like to thank the chemists in the Pion Analytical Service in the webinar, Sam Lee, Imogen Knight, Andy Kennedy, Vin Connor, and Emily May, and also Elisabeth Bosch, Elisabeth Fuguet, Elisenda Fournais from the University of Barcelona. Thanks so much for attending this webinar. If you have any questions, please send them to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Clara. Thanks, Rebecca. I really appreciate it. I think we have time for some questions. I know there are some questions posted in the Q&A. So I'll turn it over to Andrew, and I think you're going to read off some of the questions for Rebecca and Clara.
Yes, thank you, Karen. And thank you to Rebecca and Clara for the webinar. Yes, we've got some questions coming in. I'm conscious that we have a short period of time for answering the questions, so we'll answer a few now, and then any that we don't get to, if you continue to write them into the Q&A box, we will capture them and we will answer them after the webinar and disseminate this information along with the recordings and everything else. So I'll start off with a question for Rebecca first off. Regarding the measuring the pKa in the presence of co-solvents, does the pSKA move in the same way with different solvents and at different percentages?
Using different solvents, because we are using water as well, we are having different mixtures of solvent and the water, and they will affect differently because the electrostatic interaction between the compound and the two solvents, like the dielectric constant, how are different. And not only that, the solvation and the acidic constant of the solvent mixture is also affecting the way that the solvent mixture is interacting with the compound. So yes, different solvent mixture will affect differently, and how the pSKA will move will be different if we compare with different methanol or acetonitrile in water. And not only that, even we can see that the movement is opposite between solvents. So yes, the short answer is yes, different solvents will shift the pSKA in a different way.
Okay, thank you, Rebecca. I have some questions also coming in for Clara. So during your part of the presentation, you mentioned that you classified compounds into one of three groups when assessing the effect of plazodones on the solubility. Do all compounds fall within these three groups, are there any other alternative behaviors that we see when assessing the impact of plazodones on compound solubility?
Okay, actually, we only detect these three behaviors. This is the formation of amorphous forms, the extension of the time of supersaturation, or the non-interaction. But it depends on, in fact, the behavior depends on the drug and the excipient that you select. Perhaps you can see another type of interactions or the behavior. Perhaps you can see a mix between amorphous and an extension of times. So I think that our experience said that it's not a rule that every type, you can study every interaction that you can study.
Okay, thank you. Handing back over to Rebeca now then. If the log P of the ionic species is also extracted in the presence of certain background salts and electrolytes, does the log P depend on the concentration and the salt in solution?
Okay, this is a tricky question because the definition of the log P for the neutral species is defined by the concentration and it shouldn't be affected. However, as I show in the presentation, ionic species could be extracted and could be extracted in form of the ion pairs. So they are, yes, affected, but the ions dissolve in the media. So if the ionic species is extracted, will affect the equilibrium, so it's going to affect the log P. But not only that, because the method that we have using the SiriusT3, we need the pKa measure in the same media as we are measuring the log P. So if we change the salt for the log P measurement, we need to determine this pKa, and this pKa, yes, it's going to change because we have more ions in solution. We change the ionic strength. So if we change the pKa, the log P will be affected. Yes.
Thank you, Rebeca. Another question now for Clara. You mentioned that we're in the third group of compounds you mentioned. We don't see any interaction with the plazodones in solution. Do we have an understanding of why we don't see the interaction of the plazodones with the compounds in this third group?
Okay, we believe that the hydrogen bond has a great importance in the interaction between plazodon and drug, where the plazodon is the hydrogen bond acceptor and the drug hydrogen bond donor. Practically, the bases selected, which do not interact with plazodon, have not an hydrogen atom that can act as hydrogen bond donor. And then, if they don't have this hydrogen atom, they cannot interact with the plazodon. So we believe this must to be confirmed, but we believe that this interaction is the one that is most important for obtain supersaturated solutions.
Thank you. Rebeca, we have some questions coming in about the polymorphs of different compounds that you find when studying these compounds with the Chexol technique. Is the Chexol technique able to find all possible polymorphic forms of a compound, or are there any limitations that we see when performing these experiments?
Yes, there are limitations, and mainly it's depending of the sample actually, because Okay, the example that I explained with triclosan is you could see that was two forms, and then the transition between one and the other was after 20 minutes. But if we have a compound that the transition between the two forms is, I don't know, 4 hours, then the experiment is much longer. Not only that, our checksum method, I said in the presentation that the minimum of the cycles was 10 cycles. However, we can perform until 500 cycles. But okay, if we do 500 cycles, counting really quickly, this will be around 20 hours. So after 20 hours, we are in a really low volume. We are in 1.5 milliliters of water of the media. And yeah, maybe after 20 hours, the media will dissolve. So it's really depending of how long is the transition and how many forms. And another thing that I forgot to say is that because it's under argon, obviously the argon is going to help to evaporation. So if the transition is quick and it's not so much forms, we can detect it. But anyway, definitely we can detect the first ones if they are quick and the final one, the more stable.
Excellent. Thank you, Rebeca. Unfortunately, I'm conscious of the fact that we're running up close to the hour now. We have got some more questions that I'm afraid we don't have time to get to. So apologies if we haven't answered your particular question during the webinar. As I mentioned previously, all the questions will be captured and we will be answering these and following up with the answers after the webinar. So please do continue to write them in if you have any remaining questions. But with the remaining couple of minutes left, I'm going to hand back to Karen for a couple of closing words. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Andrew. And thank you everyone for attending, and thank you to Clara and to Rebeca for presenting. It was great and informative. So we will be sending out the Ring Central link. It takes a couple days, so you'll be getting that. But if you do have any questions, I think you have my email as well from the registration, so feel free to send me those, and I'm happy to find someone who can answer your question, answer it myself, and add it to the Q&A if it's particular to the seminar. So thank you everybody, and enjoy the rest of your day or evening.